And now it is my great pleasure to introduce to you our speaker today. And I'm really glad he came because you would have gotten to not only hear the story of Margaret and I swimming with the dolphins in Mexico, but I've got a DVD about it too. So, Mayor Jim Brainard gave his first State of the City address in 1996. In 1996, Bob Dole and Bill Clinton had just met in their first debate. Lindy Infante was the Colts head coach and Jim Harbaugh was the quarterback. I think he's back again. No. They were on their way to a 9-7 season, a wild card playoff berth, and a loss to the Steelers. Some things never change. The number one TV show was ER, followed by Seinfeld and Friends, and we went to the movies in order to see Jerry Maguire. Lots of people, although not me, were listening to the Spice Girls, who in 1996 had the number one song. Carmel's population was 27,000. There was no arts and design district. There was no development on Old Meridian, and we did not have one roundabout. Jim Brainard has led Carmel through a transformational 14 years and will begin his fifth term as mayor in January of 2012. Please join me in welcoming Mayor Jim Brainard.
Thanks, Linda. I want to thank everybody here today for coming, and I want to thank our chamber for providing a venue and hosting this event. But very importantly, I want to thank the city employees that are here today. We appreciate their talent, their exceptional service to our city, and their dedication. There's one of my favorite quotations is, when you look at a city, it's like reading the hopes, aspirations, and pride of everyone who built it. And these city employees, we couldn't do it without them. So please stand up and let's give them a great round of thank you applause. I also want to recognize the city council members that are here today. Sometimes we disagree, that's our system, and as a result of thoughtful discussion over those disagreements, we hopefully do a better job. So I'd like to ask them to stand and be recognized as well. As Dr. Smurz pointed out, this is the 15th state of the city for me, and I'm sure if you were honest with me, probably a lot of you were thinking, what in the world can he say that's new or different at this point? But I do want to point out that cities are never complete. They're always evolving and they're always changing. And the city of Carmel is not an exception to that. There are always new projects to be done. There's always improvements to make. But I think it's important first to look back. And one of the first things that I used in one of my speeches years ago, and I'm going to use this quotation again, it's from Daniel Burnham, the Chicago architect. And he said, "Make no little plans. They have no magic to stir men's blood. Make big plans. Aim high in hope and work, remembering that a noble logical diagram once recorded will not die." And so what I want to show you first is a brochure that we actually printed in 1997 to explain some of the things that we were proposing then. One item on this brochure was the Carmel City Center. We talked about a mixed-use pedestrian-based area. We talked about extending 126th Street west from Rangeline, what's now called City Center Drive. In that brochure, we also talked about how we only had not very many park acres. I think in 96 we started with 41 acres. By 97 we might have been up to 200, but we talked about expanding that system to its almost 800 acres, which is what we have today. We talked about how we needed to improve Old Town. and turn it into specialty retail. We talked about what could be done there. We talked about building this new road that was under construction called Hazel Dell Parkway. We talked about completing Pennsylvania Street. I remember the first week I was mayor, I was driving along 116th of Pennsylvania. I looked south and the roads are generally in pretty good shape. And I looked south and I saw this pothole filled road south of 116th. I called our street commissioner. He said, well, it's not ours, that's a private road. Pennsylvania Street had not yet been extended south of 116th Street. The Meridian Street Corridor, that road, we talked about redoing it in this brochure from 1997. It's sometimes fun to look back at those materials to see how we have progressed. I think it's probably appropriate to briefly review why we have chosen to redevelop the center part of the city. So many cities across the country have created financial issues for themselves by building so much infrastructure farther and farther out in the country that they can't pay for it all with reasonable taxes. And they do this while in the center of their city is very old development, but streets are still there, staff fire stations are still there, there's still multi-million water and sewer lines underneath the streets, yet this area from a revenue standpoint for that city is virtually abandoned because many times people aren't living in those areas. Commerce and business is not taking place. And so if we can attract private sector capital to these areas that are run down in the central part of our city, where we already have fire stations, we already have police patrols, we already have this, you know, $5 million a mile road in place. The cost of infrastructure is absolutely tremendous. That was when I first became mayor, I remember being just totally astounded at how much it costs to build a road per mile. So what we've tried to do in Carmel is to say we already have so much infrastructure in the central area, let's try to spend a fraction of the money that we would otherwise spend to recreate that infrastructure farther and farther out in the country. Let's try to get capital come back into the center of the city. And so we've done that. We've done that through the mechanism. It's much harder to redevelop an older area than it is to develop new. A green field is a blank slate. Just go do it. It's expensive, but you can go do it. You have smaller cut-up lots, you may have some environmental issues, developers like big lots. So that's where the city comes in. How can we incentivize and work with the private sector to attract this capital to the center of the part of the city? And to the extent that we do that well, I believe we've done something very good for taxpayers because it's much more, makes a lot more fiscal sense. In Carmel's case, we're one of these new cities that grew up basically as a suburb after World War II. Remember that we didn't get over 50% car ownership in this country until after 1945 when the Second World War ended. So, and there was tremendous overcrowding in the cities because there hadn't been a lot of building during the Depression, and then materials, raw materials were rationed during the war. There was crowding. Most people still heated their homes with coal. The central cities were still fairly dirty. And suddenly America was on top of the world. People had good jobs, cars were cheap, gasoline was even cheaper. And so people suddenly could escape those older cities, move out to the suburbs. They still came into the city for their jobs in the daytime. And then, so we developed these beautiful, basically suburban, sprawling suburbs. But then the internet, fax machine first, then the internet came along, and suddenly people didn't need to be all clustered at work in a centralized area. They moved their offices close to their homes. And back when I ran the first time in 1995, I kept hearing people say, you know, we'd like to be able to go out for a dinner or a show in Central Carmel. We'd like not to have to drive a long way when we go out in the evening. By the way, what can we do with that old abandoned Kroger just north of City Hall? Can we fix up Old Town? People were crying out, we want a traditional city. We want all the advantages of a suburb, but we still want a very traditional city center. We want a place to show relatives and friends when they visit from out of town. We want a place we can be proud of that helps identify and creates a sense of place for our city. So as we started our public-private partnership that became our new downtown, our city center, we kept those things in mind. And in fact, those were actually the reason for doing it. And I think it's probably appropriate to look back at the progress we've made. People sometimes forget, I think, that we've had many phases of the city center come before the current ones. First, City Center Drive, the apartments and condos by the Reflecting Pool on 3rd Avenue, the Veterans Memorial, anchored by that beautiful sculpture by Indiana artist Bill Wolf, the Ryland Townhomes along the north side of City Center Drive, the Hoosier Realty Building on the corner of City Center and 3rd Avenue, Salon 101, Shapiro's Delicatessen, the Kitchen Rite, the Flagstar Bank. And you can see a pattern in these public-private partnerships that we did to establish that city center. That the buildings are moved up to the street. We focused on pedestrian areas. We focused on making those streets beautiful. And then, of course, PEDCOR's office buildings, what was the co-seeing condominiums on the south side of the Reflecting Pool, and then now the PEDCOR apartments, condominiums, retail at the corner of 126th in Rangeline. One of the things the City Center Extension did for us was to create a better east-west connection over to the Pennsylvania and US 31 corridor where we had so many workers during the daytime in Carmel. So that's the history of our city center, and it's very fun to look at it today and think about the way it looked 15 years ago. It was very different. What has happened then in the last year since the last state of the city in the city center? Well, we've had our Palladium open, one of a dozen and a half or so true concert halls in the United States. We've had ticket sales off the charts. Never envisioned that it would do so well the first year. This building's made of Indian limestone. It's steel. It's built to last for the next couple of millennia. And we've gotten great reviews, just not locally, but nationally and internationally, on the beauty of the building. And I firmly believe that public architecture ought to inspire, ought to set the standard for the city in which it's located. We've also opened the 200-seat studio theater, a black box theater, in the building across from the Palladium, and the 500-seat Tarkington Drama Theater. Also importantly to this project, we've had hundreds of millions, as I talked about all those previous public-private partnerships, that capital investment coming into our city center is at this point probably somewhere around the $400 million mark, or at least approaching that number. We've had a tremendous investment by the private sector in this area to help create this downtown. The residential and commercial areas continue to track and fill out far ahead of other projects in Indiana and across the country. It's exciting now to see the activity in the plazas of the city center. If you haven't been in this area recently, drive up on the platform above the parking in 126th and Rangeline, walk around the Reflecting Pool and see the energy and the excitement of the people living and working in this area. I have the pleasure today to announce that yet another private sector firm has chosen to put its Indiana headquarters in the city center, and that's a Periculum Company, which is moving from Indianapolis. They're going to be on the ground, in the James Building, which is the same building the Tarkington Theater is located in. And this will be their headquarters location, and hope to be actually relocated there about the second week in November. The Center Green at the city center is open, and of course is now the home to the Carmel Farmers Market. As we talk to the folks that own restaurants around Carmel, since the Palladium and these developments have opened, restaurant business has been better than ever in spite of the national economy. And so we're starting to really see the economic impacts of the public-private partnerships pay off.